All right, that should work. All right, so before I get started, I want you to just take out a piece of paper and take a couple minutes to answer the two following questions. So what is race? Just jot down anything you can think of, a definition that you kind of come up with in your head. I'm not going to force you to share, but I'll ask you if you can. And then list the key characteristics or features of what race is. So just take a minute or two to do that. All right, so just by a show of hands, how many of you found it difficult to define what race is? If that was a tough job for you. Okay, so most of the room. And also raise your hand if how many of you included in the characteristics that you were saying made up race included some genetic or biological features. Okay, all right. All right, so the point of what I'm going to do today, I basically have one point, so hopefully you can walk away with at least this one message, is that race does not have a biological basis. Instead, race is a social category and one that leads to important differences and inequalities across the globe. And when I teach this in my intro to anthro class, this is by far the hardest concept for students to wrap their heads around because we think of race as being obvious, right? Because we can identify it with our eyes. But in fact, there are 10 points that I'm going to share with you today that kind of hopefully will help you come around, and you'll be on board with me by the end of this 55 minutes that race is a social category, but albeit an important one. All right. Okay, but before I do that, I asked some of my former students of color to answer an anonymous survey. I asked them two questions. The first was to tell me about their experience as a student of color here at CSB SJU, and then the second was to maybe provide some solutions to how they think our campuses could be more inclusive. I wanted to include the voices of students of color, and in particular in this polarizing time, in the political context, I wanted to kind of emphasize the importance of listening to each other, no matter what side of the aisle you're on. So I'm just going to present these without comment before I move on to convincing you that race is a social category. So for the first question, what has your experience been like as a student of color at CSB SJU? And these are just direct quotes from their anonymous responses, so I don't know who answered these. Being a student of color at CSB SJU has been like walking on a quiet sidewalk at night but hearing creepy voices saying racial slurs. However, once you turn around, you don't see anyone. It has been a roller coaster ride being here. At times, it's so difficult to get through the day without getting so many stares as if I had a sign on my forehead that says different. Then there's other times that I feel empowered because I have the ability to have a different perspective on things and talk about my culture and my experiences. At times, I feel a part of the minority community, and at times, I feel a part of the white community. Last year, at cultural events, I was proud to show my love for my culture, and I noticed many minorities doing the same. But I feel there needs to be more white students involved with the issues there are with race and social class, and I feel the school has been working to push for that inclusion. Coming into campus, I expected a welcoming environment, people being friendly to one another. Although this was the case for many people, there were also some that did the exact opposite. It was hard to be myself. Many of the students made sure you knew that you were there because the school needed diversity and not because you worked hard to get there like they did. I've had three girls tell me to go back to wherever I came from because they didn't like the way I was looking at them. So I asked, what do you think CSBSJU could do to be more inclusive for students of color? And these are some of the responses. I don't think there is ever going to be something anyone can do. I believe we need more diverse faculty and staff, but those who do not care won't change no matter how many lectures, speakers, or classes one forces them to take. Attend events regarding issues surrounding racial, gender, cultural issues. I think I know plenty of students who have the capability of changing their behavior but aren't introduced to the perspective of the minority on a regular basis. I believe having workshops, presentations, and celebrations of culture, then maybe people may be inclined to join and listen. I think the first step should be to know that these issues exist. It's easy to think that at a liberal school like CSBSJU, everyone accepts one another and is welcoming, but there are problems that are not obvious and not easy to see. Being aware of these issues is the first step. The worst feeling is someone assuming that your problems don't exist because it's hard to understand something you don't think exists. All right, so just kind of digest those, and I encourage you to move forward with a mentality of listening. So here are the 10 things we're going to break down, and I'm going to give examples of each of them, and that's what we're going to do today. Number one, race is a modern idea. Number two, race has no genetic basis. Number three, human subspecies don't exist. Number four, skin color really is only skin deep. Number five, most variation is within, not between races. Number six, slavery predates race. Number seven, race and freedom evolved together. Number eight, race justified social inequalities as natural. Number nine, race isn't biological, but racism is real. And number 10, colorblindness will not end racism. So I'll take each one of these in turn. So first of all, race is a modern idea. And this isn't to say that social inequality is new. In fact, ancient societies like the Greeks didn't divide people according to their physical differences, but according to religion, status, class, or even language. The English word race turns up for the first time in a 1508 poem by William Dunbar referring to a line of kings. So that's the first time the word race is used to talk about physical differences among people, but even then it was about elites. And it was a little while before race became the sort of basis of social inequalities. If you look at, one of the ways to look at the emergence of this idea of race being based on social inequalities is if you look at art representations of Africans. So you look at changes over time and see how the idea of race kind of emerged along with the African slave trade. This is a picture of the Gift of the Magi from the late 15th century, and the three Magi, one of them is African, and the only difference, it's hard to tell from, it's sort of a dark reprint here, but the only difference between these Magi in their clothes, in their compartment, and where they are in the picture, the composition, even in their facial features, the African Magi was painted with typical kind of Western European features, is the color of his skin. So in this painting, we see no kind of differentiation based on race. This is a 17th century painting of an ambassador from the Congo, and this could be a person in the European court. He's sort of looking handsome and noble and respectable. He's wearing clothes of the nobility, and is depicted in sort of equal footing with other nobility. And even the fact of choosing to depict this noble, you know, gives that idea that this idea of race had not yet emerged. Then all the representations of Africans really start to shift after the emergence of the slave trade. This is a 19th century painting by Everett of a Shaka slave market. Again, it's a little hard to see the facial features close up, but they're clearly painted. The head shape, the face of the facial features are painted in a way in order to kind of make the slaves look almost animalistic. And the reason for this is because if you're going to have a slave trade where you enslave millions of people, you couldn't do that if you think of them as equals, right? So people's ideas start to change, and then the representations in art start to change as well. All right, so the second point is that race has no genetic basis. Not one characteristic, trait, or even gene distinguishes all the members of one so-called race from all the members of another so-called race. I'm going to be showing you a handful of clips from a great PBS series called Race, the Power of an Illusion. It's got three parts to it. There's no way to embed the links into my presentation, so I'm just going to kind of awkwardly switch over to them, if I can figure out how to do that. But I've got them all queued up here, so it shouldn't be too bad. So we're going to watch a clip about this idea that race has no genetic basis.
There is no question that individual human beings are different, one from the other. Our eyes confirm this day in and day out. Skin color, body shape, hair form, eye shape. For several hundred years, we have used these visual differences to classify people into four or five groups we call races.
We have a notion of race as being divisions among people that are deep, that are essential, that are somehow biological or even genetic, and that are unchanging, that these are clear-cut, distinct categories of people.
And the beauty of the race business is that you can identify people by just looking at them. You don't even have to look at their genes because one manifestation of their genes is there, namely skin color or eye shape or hair shape. And then that's the key to everything.
The idea of race assumes that simple external differences rooted in biology are linked to other, more complex internal differences, like athletic ability, musical aptitude, intelligence.
Hopefully the next clip will work better. Do you know, is there a tech person here that might know why the video wasn't working? They're gone. All right, well, we'll just roll with it and see what happens. At least you can hear the audio. Okay. All right, so instead of race having this genetic basis, race becomes this idea that emerges at a certain point in history. And it's an idea that's created and constructed to further political and economic goals. So let's see if the second clip works here. Maybe I loaded too many clips.
All men are created equal. All men are created equal. It's the lofty and revolutionary ideal at America's core. Yet it was written at a time when some inhabitants were held in bondage, and others were being dispossessed of their lands. How did American society justify unequal treatment based on skin color and national origins? How did it reconcile that contradiction? America created a story of race.
Race was never just a matter of how you look. It's about how people assign meaning to how you look.
We have the idea that it's somewhere written in stone that there are these fundamental differences between human beings. We don't realize that race is an idea that evolves over time, that it has a history, that it is constructed by a society to further certain political and economic goals.
All right, so the third point is that human subspecies don't exist. I think this is probably the easiest one to come around to. Modern humans haven't been around long enough, evolutionarily speaking, nor have populations been isolated enough to evolve into separate subspecies or races. And we're one of the most genetically similar of all species. On average, only one of every 1,000 of the nucleotides that make up our DNA differ from one human to another. If you're a science-oriented person, maybe that will make sense to you. Number four is skin color really is only skin deep. So the genes for skin color have nothing to do with the genes for hair form, eye shape, blood type, musical talent, athletic ability, or forms of intelligence. And knowing someone's skin color doesn't tell you anything about them, right? But these are things people debate, whether or not certain races have better musical ability or athletic ability or are faster runners or are stronger or whatever. And even when we think about characteristics, we think of, even when we're thinking about characteristics that are good, like being great at music or being a good athlete, we still attribute those to that they're rooted in biology when they in fact are not. But this doesn't mean that skin color isn't a very salient and powerful way of categorizing people. We obviously know that living in America, right? And in fact, we use the phenotypical presentation of biological markers, most especially skin color, but also other facial features and hair types, as a way of organizing and categorizing people in society regularly. So anthropologists have this idea they call the rule of hypodescent, which is basically that in America, a child of a union of people from two different socioeconomic groups, including races, automatically gets placed into the less privileged group. And it's only been very recently that on the census you can select more than one racial category. Previously, you were to select the group of the minority, the less privileged minority that you belong to. So even if you ignore the census, that's kind of how we think about people, right? We group them into we categorize them in terms of the race that they belong to that's less socioeconomically advantaged in America historically. Number five is that most variation is within, not between races. And of the small amount of total human variation, 85% exists within any small local population. And about 94% can be found within any continent. So that means, for example, that two random people from Korea may be as genetically different as a Korean and an Italian or something like that. So I'm going to show you another little clip to talk about that point.
What about other genetic differences?
You're different.
The problem for evolutionists and population geneticists was always to try to actually characterize how much genetic variation there was between individuals and groups. And I spent a lot of time worrying about that, like other people in my profession.
In the 1960s, Richard Lewington decided to find out just how much genetic variation fell within and how much between the groups we regard as races. A new technology enabled him to do pioneering work.
And that method, which is called gel electrophoresis, a very fancy name, we were able to use on any organism at all. If you could grind it up, you could do it. That included people. I mean, you don't have to grind the whole person, but you could take a little bit of tissue or blood. Over the years, a lot of data were gathered by anthropologists and geneticists looking at blood group genes and protein genes and other kinds of genes from all over the world. I mean, anthropologists just went around taking blood out of everybody. I must say, if I were a South American Indian, I wouldn't have let them take my blood, but they did. And so I thought, well, we've got enough of these data. Let's see what it tells us about the differences between human groups.
Lewington's findings were a milestone in the study of race and biology.
If you put it all together, and we've now got that for proteins, for blood groups, and now with DNA sequencing, we have it for DNA sequence differences, it always comes out the same. 85% of all the variation among human beings is between any two individuals within any local population. Between individuals within Sweden, or within the Chinese, or the Kikuyu, or the Icelanders.
To put it another way, of the small amount of variation in our genes, there is apt to be as much difference between Gorgeous and her teammate Christine as there is between Gorgeous and her opponent Kaylin. Any two individuals within any so-called race may be as different from each other as they are from any individual in another so-called race.
Are the people who we call black more like each other than they are like people who we call white, genetically speaking? The answer is no. There's as much or more diversity and genetic difference within any racial group as there is between people of different racial groups.
So it's important to note that I'm not trying to argue, and nobody would try to argue, that everything was like rainbows and butterflies before we thought of this idea of race, and then everything kind of became very unequal. Slavery actually predates this idea of race. And I talked a bit about that at the beginning, but throughout much of human history, societies have enslaved others, often as a result of conquest or debt, but not because of physical characteristics or a belief in this natural inferiority. And there's something very pernicious about that naturalization that I'll talk about in a moment. And due to a unique set of historical circumstances, the North American slave trade was the first time that all slaves shared physical characteristics and an ancestry. They were all taken from West Africa. So number seven is that race and freedom evolved together. All men are created equal is the founding principle of our nation, right? But our early economy was largely based on slavery. So how can you reconcile one of the founding principles of the country and the fact that the emergence of that union was based on the labor of slaves? Well, you have this new idea of race that helps support that, right? So when we say all men, we don't really mean all men. At least at that time we didn't, and hopefully we do now. But this new idea of race helped people to justify pulling people from their villages in West Africa, shipping them across the ocean, and then using their labor to build up the economy that we still are sort of rested on today. And a great article, if any of you have read it in your classes, or that kind of helps to understand the sort of debt our economy owes to the labor of slaves, is Ta-Nehisi Coates' The Case for Reparations from the Atlantic. So if you're interested in reading more about this, I would suggest checking that out. So number eight is that race justified social inequalities as natural. Anthropologists are often thinking about how culture becomes naturalized. So, you know, we think of, for example, our practices and beliefs, maybe how we organize our families or who we think of ourselves as related to, like how we trace our descent, who we think we should marry, what kinds of ways we raise our children. We think of those things as being natural. And it's only once we start to compare cultures that we realize that those are in fact cultural, right? Like when we see that someone else does something vastly different than us, but they think that that's the way that it's always been done and should be done, then we sort of understand that culture becomes naturalized in a lot of ways. Not to say, this is sort of the nature-nurture debate, and that's not to say that nothing is attributable to biology, but that a lot of things that get assumed to be natural are in fact cultural. And that's, this idea of race becomes naturalized. And so that allows social inequalities based on race to be viewed as common sense, because they stem from this natural occurrence in the world, not something that we've imposed on these categories. And this is backed up by scientific racism. So there emerges this whole branch of science. People would kind of team up with missionaries that were working around the world and go and measure people very inaccurately, like measure their arm length and their nose length, and even take skulls of people who had passed away and kind of fill them with sand to see how big their cranial capacities were. And so they developed this so-called objective, you know, we think of science as objective, so we trust it, sort of comparative chart of all the races, showing that there's a hierarchy that imbues kind of intellectual and moral capacities to it. And this sort of branch of science is justified by this idea of race. So I'm gonna show you another little clip here.
By 1910, 58% of American mining and factory workers were immigrants. Like Mexicans and African Americans, Italians, Slavs, and Jews were often desired as laborers, but also feared, seen as promiscuous, lazy, or stupid. Some saw it as a racial invasion. Charles Davenport, a famous biologist, expressed those fears in 1911. The population of the United States, wrote Davenport, will, on account of the great influx of blood from southeastern Europe, rapidly become darker in pigment, smaller in stature, more given to crimes of larceny, kidnapping, assault, murder, rape, and sexual immorality. And the ratio of insanity in the population will rapidly increase.
And this was also a time when scientific race theory began to take off, and people began to look at society and look at groups of people in more racialized terms. So people were perceived as being separate races. So you had kind of a higher order of white races, you know, which were seen as the Nordics, as opposed to what many of the nativists called the lower races of Europe.
There are various groups like the American Breeders Association, the Eugenics Research Association, who not only are doing research on various racial types, in this case, Hebrews, Slavs, Mediterraneans, what we would call now the Caucasian race, would break it down to 35 or 37 or 45 races for study. And a lot of the language was beginning to get at the idea that those differences were actually rooted in reproduction. They were rooted in inheritable traits. They were heritable, they were biological, they were immutable.
The more the newcomers were forced into low-paying jobs and diseased tenements, the more these conditions were explained as natural consequences of their innate racial character. Biology was destiny.
So this brings us back to our original point. Don't worry, we're not done yet. You can't start shuffling around. Is that race isn't biological, but racism is real. That race does not have a biological basis, and hopefully you're somewhat on board with that now. If you're not, you should watch the whole first video of the Race, the Power of an Illusion. But race is a social category and one that leads to important differences in inequalities across the globe. I want to give you an example, one of the most poignant examples of inequalities. I'm going to stick to the U.S. for today, and this is structural inequalities that lead to housing differences. And this has really had a huge impact on Mexican populations, black populations in particular, in the U.S. So structural inequality is basically where one category of people have unequal status to another category of people, and these unequal statuses or differences are maintained through unequal rights, opportunities, and roles. So it's the structures of society keep a particular group from advancing over another. And so I'm going to show you a couple clips of two of the things that occurred. Basically, there was sanctioned economic policies and practices that, such as redlining and white flight, that led to the sort of geographical makeup of American cities today. So I'm going to show you two clips from that, and then we'll talk about it.
11th Levittown, and we found the model house, and we walked in, and we looked around, and of course, in the eyes of a young man who was raised in the ghetto, so to speak, it was an interesting experience, an interesting lifestyle, seeing all the new modern conveniences. Very fascinating.
Eugene Burnett came home with almost a million other black GIs. They had fought for the country in segregated ranks. They returned hoping for equality and the American dream. For many, that dream was a new home for little money down and some of the easiest credit terms in history.
I went up to the salesman. We're interested in your home, we're interested in buying one, and what is the procedure? Is there an application to be filled out? So forth. So he looked at me, looked around, and he said to me, he says, listen, it's not me, but the owners of this development have not as yet decided to sell these homes to Negroes.
It was as though it wasn't real. You can't imagine. But for someone to come out and actually tell you that they can't sell to you. You know, I was really on an up. Man, look at this house. Can you imagine having this? And then for them to tell me because of the color of my skin, I can't be a part of it.
The FHA underwriters warned that the presence of even one or two non-white families could undermine real estate values in the new suburbs. These government guidelines were widely adopted by private industry. Race had long played a role in local real estate practices. Starting in the 1930s, government officials institutionalized the national appraisal system, where race was as much a factor in real estate assessment as the condition of the property. Using this scheme, federal investigators evaluated 239 cities across the country for financial risk.
So that those communities that were all white, suburban, and far away from minority areas, they received the highest rating, and that was the color green. Those communities that were all minority or in the process of changing, they got the lowest rating, and the color red. They were redlined. As a consequence, most of the mortgages went to suburbanizing America, and it suburbanized it racially.
The racial logic adopts the principle that an integrated neighborhood is a bad risk, is a financial risk, that an integrated neighborhood is likely to be an unstable neighborhood, unstable socially, but therefore also unstable economically.
When the white residents of 8 Mile Road in Detroit were told they were too close to a black neighborhood to qualify for a positive FHA rating, they built this 6-foot wall between themselves and their black neighbors. Once the wall went up, mortgages on the white properties were approved. Between 1934 and 1962, the federal government underwrote $120 billion in new housing. Less than 2% went to non-whites.
I can understand an individual, depending on his environment or his family or whatever, being racist, but for your country to sanction it, give him tools to do that, there's something deadly wrong there.
All right, one last clip.
In 1968, President Johnson signed the Fair Housing Act. For the first time, racial language was removed from federal housing policy. Non-white families began moving into traditionally white communities in numbers.
We lived in an apartment, a two-family house in Queens, and when we came here, it was the first time we had bought a house, and I was looking for everything in the storybooks.
The Frisbees moved from Queens to suburban Roosevelt, only a few miles from Levittown. Like the Frisbees, many non-white families would discover the economic value of race in the real estate market. They watched as their homes and neighborhoods in suburbia declined precisely because they had moved into them.
When I moved into a neighborhood, I thought it would stay intact the way it was. On the street that I moved on when I moved there, it was predominantly white. Within 2 years, it was predominantly black.
It was called blockbusting. Real estate agents preyed on the racial fears of white homeowners to get them to sell their homes quickly for less than market value. The homes were resold to non-whites at inflated prices.
Well, they would say, you know, we're having black people move in. Now, I will give you cash if you want to sell me your house. Do you want to stay with black people next door to you? And that's the way it went on. And as Bunny said, a lot of the people just said, yes, I'll take the money and run. And that's the start of the white people leaving.
As more black and Latino families moved to Roosevelt, real estate became more and more depressed, just as the FHA had predicted. But why?
I have an idea my house is probably worth around $120 in this town. But what it would be worth in Wontoor or Garden City or some other place, probably around $200,000 or better. Now you're talking about
$80,000. Sorry. I'm covering the location. All right, we'll just skip. We're almost at the end of that clip anyway. So the last point that they make is one of the scholars, a legal scholar, John Powell, He says at the end of that clip that you didn't get to see is that his father bought a house that's probably worth $60,000, and if in that same house in one of the white neighborhoods would be worth over $300,000. So it's not just about who's living in what neighborhood. First of all, it's about building equity, right? If your grandparents came back from World War II, or maybe your great grandparents, and took advantage of this GI Bill and took their money and got an education and bought their house, and now if you're white, your family's wealth is much greater than if you're black, that's going to make a huge difference on all sorts of things. And then the characteristics of a neighborhood that's poor become attributed to race rather than these racial policies that have entrenched communities in particular places. And these things reverberate across all these different areas of life. So for example, the way we fund schools, public schools in the United States, is through the tax base. So if you live in the suburbs where property values are really high, the amount of money spent per student per year is going to be high, even at a public school. If you live in a community where the property values are very low, so taxes are lower, and you live inside the Beltway in the inner city where there are public institutions like libraries, museums, things that don't even get taxed, then the spending per student per year is going to be much lower. So for example, the disparity is in an inner city, maybe $2,000 per student per year get allocated through this tax base for this student at their school. And in the suburbs, a public school is going to be $15,000. And so you have this situation where the students that now, based on, you know, nearly a century of structural sanctioned racism through laws and policies, has fewer resources when in fact they need more. So you can see how that's really problematic. And education is just one part of that. But access to food, there are a whole bunch of issues you could explore from this particular perspective. I just want to show a couple comics. So this one says, equality doesn't mean justice. And here's three kids on a box. And the tall one is way taller. And the short one can't see, right? So this is the kind of situation with the example of the education funding where you could change things to make sure every student gets the same amount of money. But at this point, after these years of policies, that would be equality, but it wouldn't be justice, right? Because you're giving the same advantages to people who have already all these other advantages. Here's another one that kind of emphasizes that, you know, we have this bootstrap mentality of the American dream where anybody can make it. And that's technically true, but the obstacles facing someone who hasn't built up this equity, whose parents didn't go to university, who, you know, maybe doesn't even speak English in their homes so that they have more trouble writing and reading when they get to school. There's a lot of obstacles in the way that we need to compensate for, both because we care about people, but also because of the racist policies that have advantaged whites historically in the United States. All right, so the last point I want to make, number 10, is that colorblind will not end racism. And I don't even think, I mean, I went to college a while ago, but not that long ago. And I don't even think we were talking about this then. So this is, I mean, I'm sure I wasn't a scholar of race at the time. Neither am I now. But it seems to me like this is becoming more popularized in the public discourse. My students talk about this and seem to know about it. So hopefully you've heard this idea before. But just to sort of move away from the US, I want to give you an example of how a colorblind kind of attitude can be really harmful. So race in Brazil is a really interesting case, and tons of anthropologists have studied it because, well, you'll see why. So in Brazil, race is much more fluid. So people can move in and out of racial categories on a daily basis, depending on where they are geographically and throughout their lives. And there are over 500 different racial categories in Brazil, and people kind of move fluidly between them. People from the same family can have different racial labels in Brazil, and people can change their racial category, you know, through time and space, basically. And race in Brazil is not based on hypodescent, so you don't automatically have to adopt the racial category of the most marginalized, you know, makeup of your ancestry or whatever. And this sounds cool, right? Like, okay, that'd probably work. But obviously, you know, there's a but coming. Just to preface this, you know, Brazil and South America was a huge receiver of the African slave trade as well. So when we talk about the African diaspora, America got a lot, and South America and Brazil had a lot of African slaves as well, but they abolished slavery much earlier than we did. But Brazil, the problem with Brazil is there's a myth of racial democracy. So after abolishing slavery, Brazil touted itself as being very anti-racist, as not legislating racism, and it became kind of taboo to even talk about race at all. So if you were in community organizations or in the public sphere, you couldn't even talk about race as being a way that people were divided. But there were really great divisions. If you go to the favelas, the slums in Rio, they're dark-skinned Brazilians. They're not the light-skinned mestizo descent. They're African descent Brazilians. So you have this situation where there are clearly differences that are based on race, on these racial categories, but this context where you can't talk about it or address it at all. And so this helped to entrench socioeconomic differences based on race, on racial categories, with no way for people to address them, because as soon as you said, I think you're discriminating against me because I'm this race, then people would say, oh, you're racist, we don't talk about this here. So Brazil, I think, is a really clear example, but there's probably some of that goes on here, and people want to say, like, I don't care what color you are, but until, I mean, people talk about a post-racial society, but until we make a lot of changes, we need to talk about what racial groups people belong to, because that's been the basis of lots of sort of sanctioned discrimination. All right, so hopefully you're on board with me somewhat today. We've got a couple minutes left, I think. Let me see here. And about 10 minutes if anyone has any questions or wants to make any comments. Yeah.
Sorry, I'll jump in here.
Thanks. Hi, how are you?
Hi, most of you, which I'm assuming out too, but I recognize here. I'm a biology professor here. And I actually made my intro bio students do this. But I just have a question for you that I haven't had time to find an answer to.
If it's a biological question, I might not be able to answer it.
Okay. So you say no genetic base for race, right? And yet we have criminal forensics, right, that will look at the DNA and say, well, 95% certainty, I think that the criminal is X race, right? So if there's no genetic basis for race, how do you feel about that tool that we like to use?
Sure. You know, I've heard that critiqued as well as being... I'm not sure the biology underneath that, because I'm a cultural anthropologist, but I think what I've heard is, you know, that those aren't as accurate as people think that they are, and people make a lot of mistakes with that, but I would have to look into that more, and I would love to hear a scientist's perspective on that. Anyone else have insights on that? Voting scientists in there? Any other questions? Thoughts, comments? I take compliments. Just kidding. Taken very well, actually. No? All right, well, thank you guys so much for coming. I hope you have a great day.